stone. Hold your hand up high and don't be afraid of the dark. At the end of a stone there's a golden sky and the sweet silver sound of love. Walk on through the wind, walk on through the rain, for your dreams beat us and blow.
I was going through and I thought, oh,
no.
You fill up my senses like night in a forest, like the mountains in springtime, like a walk in the rain, like a storm in the desert, like a sleepy blue ocean. You fill up my senses. Come fill me again. Come let me love you. Let me give my life to you. Let me drown in your laughter. Let me die in your arms. Let me lay down beside. Let me always be with you. Come, let me love you. Come, love me. senses like the night in a forest, like the mountains in springtime, like a walk in the rain, like a storm in the desert, like the sleepy blue ocean. You fill up my senses, come fill me again.
I welcome you here today as we farewell Earnest John McKenzie, a special person in your lives. We also come together to celebrate Earnie's life, a farewell with love and reflection of those moments Earnie brought us joy or influenced us. You come here today as family and friends, united in your loss of this special person. We honour Earnie in our hearts and hold him dear in our memory. May we spend a quiet moment thinking of all those people that would like to be with us here today. I would like to thank Lorraine for giving me the honour of leading the service. My name is Nikki Boys. As we unite in loss and memory, we are reminded of the fragility of life. We remember many of the times that Earnie touched our lives and realise the uniqueness in which he crossed our pathway. May we also think about how our life impacted Earnie. Each of us here today have your own memories of Earnie. We remember his passion for horses, his love of riding and the outback, and his humour. Relly, would you like to come and share the eulogy?
Thanks, Nikki. I was really hoping it was going to be something to lean on because my hands are going to shake all over the place. But look, I know it's not the crowd they would expect to be celebrating Dad's life. We had a small group of close family and friends standing outside on a nice green lawn under some trees. Seems somewhat appropriate. Where do I start? Not there. Good. Okay. There's so much to try and jam into a short speech. If this speech went for an hour, I wouldn't do it justice. We've all had a part in today's story, and if I miss something or my dates are out, you'll get the general gist of what I'm trying to say. Earnest John McKenzie, or Earnie, Dingo, Munyai, Uncle Earn, Dad, Poppy. Had a lot of names. Born on the 30th of April 1939, but for 42 years he actually thought he was born in 1938. That was set straight in 1991 when he required a copy of his birth certificate to go overseas, and lo and behold, when he received it, he was actually a year younger than he thought. That'd be nice. Ernie's parents, George and Kathleen McKenzie, he was the eldest of what was going to be a family of six. Earnie was followed by George, who left us in 1996, Lorraine and Trevor, who join us here today, and Judy and Hayden, who are here in spirit, as they couldn't travel to get here for obvious reasons, and it was nice for Mum to get those phone calls this morning. Chasing work in the mines, the McKenzie family headed inland to the midwestern towns of Gwalia and Mount Magnet and Wallona. His schooling was a short affair, which was done mainly in Mount Magnet, but by the age of 13, Earnie had worked out he wasn't going to be a doctor, and he left school and home and headed out to the stations to start would be a lifelong relationship with the bush. For the next 7 odd years, Earnie worked as a roustabout, truck driver and stockman on many stations throughout the Murchison and the Gascoyne, including stints at Dairy Creek and Mount Phillip. Must have been around 1960 when Earnie started working on a station called Mount Narrier under his Uncle Norm and his Aunt Val. He stayed at Narrier for the next 12 to 13 years. These were formative years for the young Earnie, and with not only the station life being a highlight, but it was while he was at Narrier with Uncle Norm that he started riding as a jockey in the bush race meetings at Mergoo and later at the Landor races. The racing game would play a big part in Ernie's life. There was always funny anecdotes flying around regarding what Earnie got up to in these years, as the annual races were a time to let your hair down. There are stories around Earnie dancing on 44-gallon drums at 2 o'clock in the morning. It seems there was also a time that Earnie drove his car into the middle of the dance floor at Mergoo. And I think this passage out of a book called A Simple Life, Anything But, written by Ron Pass, gives us some more insight into this. The year was 1962, and I quote straight from the book. The entertainment at the races was in the usual high-spirited fashion, and I was able to add a bit of that with the help of one very lively young chap by the name of Earnie McKenzie. Earnie was the nephew of Norm Armstrong and was working on Mount Narrier with Norm and Val, ex-Geraldton, and had gradually inherited the rides on the Narrier horses. In the wee small hours of Sunday morning, about 4 a.m, Earnie had decided to collapse our tent and drench us with water. Nothing unusual in that, I'm sure. I was expected to retaliate, so I did. Having ran him to ground, I proceeded to strip him down to his underpants, lucky he had some on, dragged him over to the bar in the shed, tied him to a post and left him there. Seemed like a great idea at the time and did create a bit of humour. Earnie played a part in my going to Landor and remains one of our old friends of the days gone by. Earnie stayed at Narrier until late 1973, when a trip across to Carnarvon to attend the Western Festival with his great mate Bob Schmidt had a bit of an impact on Earnie. You see, it was at that festival he met a particular blonde lass, and as Earnie told the story, he said to Bob, "I'm going to marry that girl." He went back to Narrier, quit his job, headed back to Carnarvon, persistently pursued this young blonde lass for the next 2 years until she finally gave in and married him on the 6th of December, 1975. That's the day Earnie not only became a husband to the blonde, my mum Lorraine, but also a dad to my sister, Naomi, and myself. We were 9 and 5 at the time. Although Dad was now a townie, his passion for horse racing continued, and now had his soulmate to share the passion with. Dad got his trainer's license in 76, and the first racehorse he had was a grey called Noble Monk, which was a gift from Uncle Norm back at Narrier. Doing a great job. One of the first memories I have of Dad riding in a race was at Landor in 76 on Noble Monk. It was a walk-up start, and old Noble decided to get stuck into it, and as the starter let them go, and as a result, Dad had to get him under control and started about 10 lengths last. Now, they didn't win the race, but seeing the grey horse flying through the dust with the black and purple sash colours catching the rest of the field amazed the six-year-old me. Looking back, watching Dad ride, whether it was as a jockey or in the local barrel race, he always amazed me. He was an extraordinary horseman. Mum and Dad started to build on the race stables and had various horses like Ned a Bit, Nippy King, another grey, Skokian, who they won the Mulga Stakes with, Duperusel, and then they leased a couple from Northam. Now, the two from Northam were named Red Morning Sun and Morning Is Broken, and you might pick that in one of the songs a bit later. But to be honest, they couldn't run out of sight on a dark night. But these two horses stayed on as hacks after Dad finally made the decision to stop training. That decision was made after he started to get too heavy to ride and had to engage the professional jockeys for the ride. But Morning Is Broken's stable name was Boss. He was an interesting horse to say the least. And that's Dad riding Boss on the back of today's program. To stay connected to the racing game, Dad became the clerk of the course, first using Mum's favourite horse, old Mac Macassar, then Nippy the Grey. During Dad's time as a clerk of course, he trained a couple of apprentices in Mum and me, and we continued on after Dad became the official starter at the race club. Where our years were scheduled by race meetings and horses, we always looked forward to the summers when the horses were out. We would pack up whatever little runabout we had, whether it's a little yellow Mini Moke or the old Daihatsu that we just passed down on the corner there, still parked up, rusting away. We'd pack it up with a barbecue and we'd head out into the bush, following Dad's directions for miles, only to end up under some random gum tree or a wattle bush. We'd light a fire, boil a billy, burn some lamb chops to a crisp, have a feed, then head back home. As a kid, I couldn't work out why Dad would pick these particular spots. It wasn't like they were near a scenic waterhole or a river. They'd just be a bush in the middle of the scrub. When I look back on it now, it was just Dad's way of getting back to the bush that he loved so much. Doing the simple things like having a cup of tea and a feed, sitting under the shade of a tree. He would have done that 1,000 times in his youth, and that's taught me to appreciate the simple things in life, and I still love burnt lamb chops. Talking to teaching people and passing on Dad's love for the bush lifestyle, I couldn't stand here without mentioning the Carnarvon Horsemen's Club. This was a club dreamed up by Mum and Dad sitting around their kitchen table, and the idea turned into reality in 1983. Initially for horsemen over the age of 15 to get out on their horses as a collective and have some fun, this was soon opened up to riders of all ages. The club exposed a whole new generation of young horse riders to the pleasures and fun of the bush and bush gymkhanas, rideouts, campouts, stations like Bullethana and Brickhouse. We even done a relay ride to Gascoigne Junction and returned to raise some money for the Flying Doctor. Great times, great memories for so many people. Whatever we were, whatever we did, whatever, wherever we were, Dad was always there to help all the kids with the riding and taught so many people better horsemanship skills. The club's still going today. I don't mind saying this, but I used to be able to sit on a horse pretty good once, and I was riding one of Dad's horses, Boss, who I mentioned earlier, at a camp draft out at Nanyatara Station. Now, Boss being Boss decided to play up, and me being me, rode it out. Then we got around to attempt to chase a cow. What sticks in my head from that day, though, is afterwards an old bloke rode up to me and he said, "You ride all right, young fella. Where'd you learn?" I said, "My dad taught me." "Guess who's your dad?" I said, "Earnie McKenzie." He just looked at me and said, "That makes sense," and rode away. Good years, good times. Moving on, year 2000, Mum and Dad packed up and left Carnarvon to head back here to Geraldton. Dad had always wanted to move back, and when heading home from a holiday in 99, Vicky Armstrong took him around to show them 58 Polo Road. They had a look, yep, meets the criteria, sold. Time to move. They moved here on the 17th of March 2000, which was the day before Mum's 32nd birthday. Dad settled into Gero life and enjoyed getting back to the Midwest area on his weekends and holidays. Went through places like Walia again and Sandstone and retraced the places of his youth. Highlight at Geraldton was, for Earnie, was one of the opportunities to work as a team leader on the scuttling of the longline fishing vessel South Tommy. The ship was to be stripped out and sunk as a dive site off the coast of Gero. Dad's team consisted of a heap of kids who were having a few issues in life and needed some direction, and again the nature of Dad shone through, winning these kids respect and helping a lot of them focus on getting the task completed. The impact that he had on the kids during that project still evident. There was actually one of the kids parked out the front today as we came in. The bush was always calling though. Mum and Dad ended up being the young help out at Blue Pool's cattle property for Alan Bain on the weekends. They'd head out, have their horses out there, and help out with whatever tasks were required. Again, this gave Dad extreme satisfaction, and he was still able to maintain that connection to the bush life. As I said at the start, Dad had a lot of names, but I think his favourite was Poppy. He was a typical doting pop, always playing games with the kids, Jamie and Mitch, always had lollies, or his wed wallies, hidden in the car to slip to the kids, getting them full of sugar and then hand them back to us. Mitch came and spent a week last school holidays with Pop. Pop had him working flat out and was telling him all the stories from his childhood. "How old are you?" 14. "I left home at 13 and was working on the stations." All good memories, eh, mate? So now the hard part. Thanks, Joe. Earnest, John McKenzie, Earnie, Dad, Poppy, slipped the rail, headed out to the Long Yard on the 8th of April, 2020. He was just short of 81 years of age, or it might have been 82. Depends what year we go with that he was born. Dad was one of these people that was young for a long time. Fit as a fiddle, always doing something well into his late 70s. Then life started to catch up. So we are here to say goodbye, but for me, it's to say thank you. One of the things I'm eternally grateful is I had this conversation with Dad about 18 months ago. Thank you for being, well, thank you for pursuing that blonde back in 73 to start with. Thank you for being a wonderful teacher, mentor, and coach to countless people, be it on a horse or scuttling a ship. Thank you for being a wonderful husband to my mum. Thank you for being a wonderful dad to my sister and me. Thanks for being a wonderful pop to Jamie and Mitchell and Liam, Naomi's boy. Thanks to being a wonderful friend, all that knew him. There's been so many chapters in your life, but it was full of love, laughter, challenges, successes, adventures, and memories. If all those chapters were written in a book, that book would teach us a lot. And it'd be a bloody good book. Thank you.
Thank you. Kim, would you like to come forward and share your memories?
Well, this is going to be a pretty short eulogy. It's pretty hard to match the one we've just heard. It was outstanding, I thought. But I knew Earnie when he first came to Carnarvon some 50-odd years ago. I knew Lorraine even longer, as we were teenagers in the Carnarvon Pony Club. Earnie worked for Lou and Barbara Burns for many, many years as their number one truck driver and salesman and whatnot. And he later transferred to Mitchell Fuels when the Burns family got out of the fuel game. He ended up as the depot manager in Carnarvon for Mitchell Fuels. He held that position till they shifted to Geraldton when he was virtually semi-retired. Earnie was an amateur jockey, well known in the Carnarvon area. He rode at the Landor, he also rode at Exmouth and Carnarvon. He always had race horses, him and Earnie, and they were well known and liked in the racing fraternity at Carnarvon. He was a starter at Carnarvon for quite a few years. And Lorraine was clerk of the course, and I think he was clerk of the course there for a while as well. However, it's the Horsemen's Club that they founded in Carnarvon that I'm going to talk about a little bit. It was something that was lacking because it was a club that where the parents and the kids could ride out together. And it was very enjoyable and very, very popular. They would go out on the weekends and and have a picnic lunch and come home. And once a year, they'd have a camp out at either the brick house shearing shed or the Bullathana shearing shed. Well, it was at this brick house shearing shed camp out that I particularly remember. They insisted Lex and my two children, George and Jane, they were riding out and I wasn't going to go, but Lorraine put a foot down and said that I have to go. Anyway, she said, I'm even supplying him the horse. And the horse was a horse I'd given her quite a few years ago called Moto Grosso. He's a very flashy chestnut horse with four white socks and a big white blaze. A bit of a sore point for me because he wasn't much good and it was the most money I'd ever, and still is, paid for a horse. Anyway, we rode this bloody horse out to the... He jig-jogged all the way. And it's 12 plus miles from Carnarvon to Brickhouse. Anyway, by the time we got there, I was that bloody sore that I had to stand up in the irons and hold onto the pommel. And anyway, we got there eventually. And of course, that night was a barbecue and dancing and guitars and bloody... I think we had a hungy there. but I never went very much on the hungy, but I was a partial to Ernie's canned pot stews, and he was a pretty good cook, made some very good stews. Anyway, during that night everyone got pretty bloody drunk and dancing around the campfire, and during the night, well, Lorraine, well, she's not, you know, she's a fairly placid person, she doesn't boil up very much, go off the handle, but she did this time. Ernie proceeded to do a strip dance around the campfire. Anyway, Lorraine bloody woman, oh, did she go berserk? And I can't remember whether she chased him around the campfire or chased him away from the campfire. But everyone was edging him on, saying, "Get your gear off, Ernie, get your gear off." Anyway, the next morning they're all pretty sore with thick heads and whatnot. And it was all over. The gymkhana started the next day, and one of those weekends that everyone had a very, very good time. By the way, Motor Grosso was floated back to Carnarvon. Anyway, this floated back to Carnarvon. And not much more I can say, but they were very enjoyable times, and I remember them very affectionately. And, well, much more I can say, just rest in peace, old fella. You earned a very good life and lived a very good one. Thank you.
Thank you, Kim. Trevor, would you like to come and share with us?
Do you have it written down? Is it in there? Yep. Afterglow. I'd like the memories of me to be a happy one. I'd like to leave afterglow a smile with life done. I'd like to leave an echo whispering softly down the way of happy times and laughing times and bright and sunny days. I'd like the tears of those who grieve to dry before the sun of happy memories that I leave when life is done.
Thank you, Trevor. There is never a good time to die. We do not want death to take from us, from those we love. May I now invite you to spend a few moments in quiet reflection of Ernie and how he has touched your life while we listen to You'll Never Walk Alone by Jerry and the Pacemakers.
When you walk through a storm, hold your head up high. And don't be afraid of the dark. At the end of a storm, there's a golden sky and the sweet silver song of love. Walk on through the wind, walk on through the rain, for your dreams beat us and blow
Joe, would you like to come and share the dust of the years?
Thank you. Just before I read this beautiful poem, just like to thank you, Ernie, for chasing that blonde too, because unknown to Ernie, he touched many people, and he brought me, my best mate, by two, in Raleigh and that, and a godson, and I'm forever grateful. I hope when you get up there, mate, you and Norm catch up and yarn about all the yurages that you raised and bred at Narrow and the good times you had. With the silks and the sunlight gleaming, with the sheens on the satin coats, with the field round the bush course streaming to the cheer of 500 throats, with the mount and the straightway trying his best outstride his peers, in the wake of swift hoofs flying, I see it, the dust of the years. With the sheep in the yard wings ringing, with the cattle rounded on camp, with the 10-ton wool load swinging, with the low-step bullocks tramp, in the sleepy township swirling as a lazy bush wind veers, on the open clay pan curling, I see it, the dust of the years. From the old life careless and idle, from the old days merry and gay, from the joys of the saddle and bridle, what dreams do we carry away? A winning ride at the races, a gallop that heated the steers, the call of the open spaces, and only the dust of the years. Thank you.
Thank you, Joe. Ladies and gentlemen, our ceremony for Earnie is almost concluded, and we now have to say a loving and tender final farewell to him. We are deeply grateful for Earnie's life and for all that life has meant to you. We thank him for the impact of his life on yours. We remember his smile, his frown, and his love of life. We remember the fun times and the hard times, the struggles and the triumphs. Earnest John McKenzie, may your soul rest in peace. Once I've lowered the coffin, family followed by friends are invited to come forward and say their personal goodbyes. And the family thank you all for your attendance here today.
Goodbye, my love. Goodbye, my love. Broken like the first morning.